So once again, this is Luis Huloch on the microphone, and I kindly invite you to follow us along this 22nd World Cup competition in the season 2004-2005. And here we have the overview on the World Cup standings. And spoiler alert, unfortunately, the first two in this ranking, so Jana Ahonen and Roa Jokelsoy, are not with us right here in Pragelato. They decided to skip those test events, but other than that, we have lots of legends with us. A handful of ski jumpers that are still active, which you hopefully will recognize easy. And this man right here, Walter Hofer, right then, still in his function as FIS race director. He recently finished, unfortunately, due to the coronavirus under very unfortunate circumstances, but of course we always pay tribute to what he has achieved and done for the sport of ski jumping. And here we see the starting order for the first round. Unfortunately, we also have to conclude that only one of the six men strong team of Italy has made it to this competition, which is Stefano Chiappolino, starting with bib number two. And with him on the qualification were Andrea Morassi, Sebastian Coloredo, Giancarlo Adami, Marco Beltrame and Alessio Bolognani. But only Chiappolino made the cuts to the best 50, which made it to the competition round, a fact that hasn't ever changed since this competition. What was different back then is that the wind and gait calculation and compensation was not existing, so the jury had to be very careful with choosing the in-run length, because if they had to change it in course of the competition, the rounds had to be restarted, and of course you wanted to avoid that. But the fact that the hill was new to basically everyone made this decision a bit tricky. But of course, with all the experts being responsible for that, they decided to choose start gate number 20 for this first competition round, and that was definitely the right choice. You can see still construction sites in the background, so the final touches on this venue were made in the upcoming summer. Basically, those venue was prepared just in order to enable these competitions in the pre-Olympic winter, and that definitely worked out. And at least from my perspective, I can say it's a bit of a shame to not have these ski jumps amongst those being in use anymore, because I think the Olympic movement always should be a bit connected to sustainability, to long-term thinking, and yeah, that didn't really work out for this complex. It was opened in 2005, but then closed in 2009, so it had only a very short period of time. The last trial jumpers going down. And then we are ready to start this competition in a very few moments. And the fact that Jana Ahonen and Roa Jokelsoy decided to skip those events were also due to their comfy position in the World Cup ranking. Up to date, Jana Ahonen has won 12 World Cup competitions of 21 that have been held, and he only took part in 17 of those, so he definitely could afford to skip these ones. And also Jokelsoy didn't really have to fear that anyone would take his second spot in the World Cup ranking. So, Jan Mazoch from Czech Republic is going to open this one. Bronze medalist of the Junior World Ski Championships in that season. Only 19 years young. And there we see Vasya Bajc, who was the Czech head coach back then. And not only the picture resolution was different to what we're experiencing these days. But let's have a look on this first jump. Around 95 kilometers an hour, the in-run speed, so kind of normal for these size of hills. A little steeper in-run than we are seeing at some other hills, but Mazoch sets the first distance with 116 meters. And now his colleagues will decide what it will be good for. The first of them, Stefano Chiapolino. And spoiler alert, it was also a very special day for the 19-year-old Italian. Doing quite a good jump. Still a bit below the heel size, and also this blue line we know from today's TV images is not appearing, but 119.5 meters gives him the lead, and from then on you can also have a look and guess if the jumpers who are coming up right now are going to take a better or weaker position. Of course, ski jumping back in the day was easier to calculate also for you as a spectator. You didn't had to take a look on the wind and gait calculation. If there are no bad mistakes in the jump, it was easier to predict who's going to take the lead. Makes it comfy to look at. But sometimes things were getting complicated. And he also had to be very patient. In the background, we also see Sepp Gratza at the in-run, today's FIS equipment controller. And there we also saw the news race director Sandro Pertile, successor of Walter Hofer, who will go into his first season. Hopefully this summer, we don't know yet. But the latest, hopefully, in the winter. But it's an interesting impression to look at some things here around where still a bit provisional. Some were already finished, but the overall feedback from the athletes was quite positive about those venues. So the Italians definitely fulfilled not only the proposal but also the expectations. Marcin Bachleda from Poland. Nowadays the assistant coach of Łukasz Kruczek at the Polish women's team. Shortest jump in the competition round for him, unfortunately. 22 years old, Bachleda was back then jumping the Rossignol skis, the French model. Also definitely a whole other world back then, equipment-wise, manufacturers that are not anymore in the game, but were ever since then. Walter Hofer knows it's a tricky one today. the wind conditions not in the corridor, as we are now experiencing the next athlete climbing to the bar, which is Robert Kranjec from Slovenia, ski flying world champion in 2012. The man with most flights above 200 meters, 210, and in his incredible career. Remarkable jumping style always, but not working out on every single ski jump, obviously. But even if we didn't have any graphics, I'm sure most of you would recognize him, the Slovenian who takes third place at the moment. Up next is Ivan Karaulov from Kazakhstan. His best result was still up to come, speaking from that perspective. Took 15th place in Sapporo 2006. But performs the shortest jump here. And it's a very puristic ski jumping event still. Only a very few spectators. I mean, the facility is quite modern, but not too entertaining, the whole environment. Also, unfortunately, the competition so far, only 107.5 meters and fifth and last position for Karaulov. Jon Oras for Norway. 2 years ago, in 2003, he took gold and silver at the European Youth Olympic Festival in Tarvisio. Ski jumping competitions were held in Planica, actually. Also jumping a model which is not being produced anymore, Atomic from Austria, one of the most successful manufacturers of skis back in the day. And Oras, who mainly competed in the Continental Cup, takes fifth position with his jump on 111.5 meters. This is Johan Eriksson, quite a while ago since we saw the last Swedish competitor in any bigger event. I think it was in Falun 2015 at the Hope World Championships. We saw Christian Ingedigen and also Karl Nordin. But Eriksson, six-time Swedish champion and only one of two Swedes to reach the magic 200 meter distance in ski flying. And now aiming for a good halftime result here. Quite a good jump for him, actually. Even though the technique, obviously, not the best, quite an unorthodox method he's choosing up there. But otherwise, got a good executed 116.5 meters and rank number 3. Mateusz Rutkowski, only 18 years young, a huge talent back then in Poland. Gold and silver at the Junior World Ski Championships in 2004, so 1 year ago from this perspective. But the range he was showing on the jumping hill was a huge one. Some jumps were awesome and brought him nice success. Some were weak, such as this one. Only 103.5 meters. And already a closed case for him. Thomas Lobben for Norway. 8 Continental Cups he has won in his career. Nowadays a member of the Norwegian coaching staff. made the decision quite early to give up professional ski jumping and rather teaching it. Young he was then, but always a bit switching between World Cup and Continental Cup. Sometimes too good for the Continental Cup, but not good enough for the World Cup, and this is also shown right here in this event. But obviously nowadays the Norwegian Ski Federation really would not like to miss him. Marco Steinauer for Switzerland. One of the older competitors, we have to say, 20 years old. There we see Bernie Schödler, who was Swiss coach back then. But seventh rank also at the lower end of the field. And this man right here, I think, doesn't need an introduction. Kami Stoch. We are watching the 18-year-old Kami Stoch a couple of years ago before he became what we know him for. But definitely his movements, his behavior, and especially the telemark, still recognizable from today's perspective. And the second position, quite a good intermediate result for him back in the day. Janne Harponen for the Finnish team, who was in a very successful era back then. And especially he is a character you could spend hours speaking about. He would surely have achieved much more than he already had in his career, but this huge talent was so unlucky with suffering from so many injuries, 3 times ACL, just to name that. And it was so unfortunate for him. And also this moment was unfortunate for him. Bad weather conditions in terms of wind, because if you watch at the weather, it is perfectly fine, but the backwind was very, very strong in that moment. And he couldn't really equalize that. Anders Bardal, also one of those living legends, overall World Cup winner in 2011-2012, so 6 years after this one, in the best athlete age of 28 he was back then, when reaching his major success right here, even though obviously he was always one of the best jumpers in terms of athletics and power strength at the takeoff, but even he could not correct the wind conditions sometimes, and that was one of those cases. And here we see the only US-American competitor, Clint Jones, from Steamboat Springs, Colorado. Surprisingly took the second place in the Summer Grand Prix overall in 2002. What? How good he was staying on his feet right there. We saw it in the past season that moments of a lack of concentration can result in very painful crashes, so the jump isn't over until you got rid of your skis. Always be careful, but in that case it didn't really matter because the point result already was not good enough for him. Dmitry Ipatov, 2 years from 2005 on, or later I should rather say, the man from Magadan became student world champion on the normal hill. So quite an impressive record of competitions Pragelato has had in the short history. 2005 Nordic Combined Ski World Cup and Ski Jumping World Cup, then 2006 Olympic Games and 2007 the Universiade, and 2008 again World Cup competitions. But that's about it. Denis Kornilov definitely has some special moments to this place. Being only 18 years young at that moment we are seeing right now. And similar to Ipatov, he became Universiade champion on exactly this hill in 2007. A fact that certainly also a Russian head coach at that time, Wolfgang Steyert, didn't know about. Sixth place for Kornilov. Still in the lead, as you probably might have heard from the stadium announcer, is Stefano Chiapolino. And the man behind the mask, luckily not a healthcare mask, is Antonín Hájek. Still Czech national record holder and current national coach in Czech Republic. Back then only 17 years of age, the youngest competitor in this field. ...107.5 meters and 11th position. But we are waiting on and on for the next still active ski jumper. Tsuyoshi Ichinoue is not one of them. Started his career as a winter sports athlete in Nordic Combined in 2000 actually, and then switched to ski jumping. But unlike other examples from his country, Junshiro Kobayashi, for instance, this change did not result in bigger successes, actually. Never really made the breakthrough to the world class. And so it also was in this competition. The purple helmet, a symbol for a whole ski jumping generation, and this man right here, one of the most successful ski jumpers ever, Martin Schmidt from Germany. ...2005, the year after his colleague Sven Hannawald retired, a difficult period for German ski jumping history with Peter Rowein as a head coach and the athletes struggling to be on top of the game. And Schmidt was just the perfect example for that, as we see his country fella Maximilian Mechler, who recently was named a coach for the German B team for the women. So he will be part of the squad that will travel around the Continental Cup from now on. Back then, 21 years young. And also hoping for better days, even though he obviously beats his teammate and takes fifth position. Another famous mask coming up right now. Kimmo Iliriesto from Finland. Born and raised in Rovaniemi, where you still could practice ski jumping until probably a week ago. He became Team Junior World Champion in 2001 and took bronze with his team 2 years later. Very remarkable jumping style, very slim V in the air, his ski ends being crossed. And the judges had a careful look on that and gave him weaker style points. And the next mask man is coming up right now, Takanobu Okabe. The oldest competitor in this field, and believe it or not, he was only 34 years of age in that very competition, the world champion from 1995 in Thunder Bay, who is now the head coach of the Snowbrand ski team. Also light issues there at the landing, but other than that, always fascinating to watch him. Also this equipment, it definitely has a retro flavor, such as everything we are watching here around. It's superbly interesting, this trip back into time. You see Hautamäki, I bet also he had no idea that it would be a great day for his younger brother. Unfortunately for himself, it was quite a disappointing one. The bassist of the Finnish crab rock band, the Kroisos, who only consisted of former athletes such as him or Ville Kante, you also might know, or Anssi Koivuranta. And there comes Morten Solem, nowadays a FIS equipment controller. Back in the day, professional ski jumper, delivering an average jump right here. But the jury, we definitely have to conclude at almost halftime of the first round, definitely was very defensive with their choice of win run. Didn't want to risk two long jumps, even though yesterday's jump by Adam Mawish to 140.5 meters was just half a meter above his height. So definitely everything under control. Jan Matura for Czech Republic. Also, he one of those guys who started their career as a Nordic combiner, and then due to the fact that the cross-country performances were not on the highest level, switched to specialized ski jumping back then. Still jumping with the Czech ski model Sporten, who is rarely visible these days, at least among senior jumpers. But that was the first half of the competition, as we still see Stefano Chiappolino in the lead, 0.3 points ahead of Camille Stoch. And Jan Bazoch, who took bib number one, still in third position. So these athletes already in the final round. As we scroll to the back, where we see the two Finns, and with Janne Harponen, another Finn, so three Finns taking the bottom three spots. So also the technical break, as we call it, was on a different place than it is these days. Not ahead of the best present 10. But now we see Andreas Hofler. It is hard to believe after this performance that just 1 year later he would become a gold medalist with the team and win silver in the individual, but lots of things can change within 1 year of time, especially the wind conditions, which are giving everyone right here a hard time. And there we saw a quick impression of the equipment control, how it was back then. Also that obviously has changed a lot ever since. Primož Peterka. The first Slovene to win the Opel World Cup in 1997. And he even reproduced that 1 year later. And in the first of these 2 years, he also won the Four Hills Tournament and also the Ski Flying World Cup. But this work shift has been a very disappointing one. Andreas Goldberger. I mean, it's a familiar face, obviously, for every one of those. Every one of you who has been present at a World Cup or an equal event, the test flyer with the helmet camera. Back then, 32 years old, in the last years of his successful career, the man who jumped over 200 meters as the first in history, but then crashed. But still a very popular guy, very respected. And still gets asked a lot of questions in his role as a TV expert and commentator for the Austrian colleagues. Rok Benkovic. One of the better jumps throughout the competition so far, even though he's not satisfied. The athlete of Matyáš Zupán, who would become a world champion only 8 days after this event in Oberstdorf from a normal hill. I mean, it still sounds unreal, a Slovene taking a gold medal from the normal hill, but he made it in the age of only 18 years. Stefan Hocke, the Team Olympic champion of 2002. So already had his major success, even though he only was 21 years of age. But this is a good jump from the Thuringian. This is Peter Rowein, German head coach back in the day. And Hocke, as we see, jumping the Garmina skis, very popular model in the former GDR. The manufacturing house still exists, but nowadays these skis are called the Flüge.de. Tami Kuro survived the equipment control and is now about to show us his jump. But it's a very similar pattern in every single jump. Jumpers have a good height from the takeoff, but in the middle of the landing slope they lose this height and also the drive. In the flight and then drop suddenly only 106.5 meters and also no second round for him. There is Jörg Ritzerfeld, a team and club colleague of Stefan Hocke, had a very unfortunate end of this year as he tore his ACL, but this injury was discovered way later, unfortunately. But apart from Martin Schmidt, German jumper still with a solid performance, we could say, especially knowing that great results for that squad were kind of rare back in these days. Eighth position, not satisfied with that. Florian Liegel, nowadays we know him as an assistant coach in the Austrian Ski Federation. Back then, he already collected his only World Cup victory. That was at Kulm in 2003, so on a ski flying hill. Slightly too late there at the takeoff. And the timing was playing an important role in that competition. Because if you miss that, it would cost you. Especially under those backwind conditions. So, the only second of the five still active athletes we have with us in this competition, Dmitry Vasiliev, 25 years young, he was back then. Providing a telemark in lower distances, still not a problem for him. For the man from Ufa, who recently underwent another of those numerous surgeries he has had through his career, but of course he won't quit ski jumping too soon. Fifth position for Vasiliev, and so he will be amongst those guys reaching the second round. From Germany, Michael Neumeier, we now know as the Nordic Combined Continental Cup coordinator. Well, certainly not the most elegant ski jumper, he also admitted several times in his career. But he also definitely had his ups in his career. Silver medalist with the team at the 2010 Olympic Games. And now also reach the final round, but not too happy about his result. Another born German, but competing for Switzerland, it's Michael Möllinger. Didn't have any future in the German Ski Federation after he was criticizing the training and especially lifestyle methods in the Team Germany, who were very radical back in the day. Jumpers needed to keep their weights very, very low, so he, also Frank Löffler, disagreed with that. And then he was not nominated anymore and switched to Switzerland, I'm sorry, and became a team colleague of this guy right here, Andreas Küttel, our world champion from 2009. The first jumper for a long time to be somewhat close to Chiapolino's performance. ...118 meters... for the Swiss living with his family in Denmark. And he was very lucky to still get 17 style points in average. A bit too high from today's perspective, we have to say. Wolfgang Leutzel, probably one of the most beautiful styles we have ever witnessed in ski jumping. Such an aesthetic telemark landing he has always had. Maybe not always, but if the distance was good, let's put it this way. He became the fifth man in history to reach five times the 20.0 style points. I'm pretty sure everyone in the age of, yeah, let's say at least 15 who already had a ski jumping passion in that age certainly will remember that moment. Jenny Damian, the third still active athlete, went from Ljubljana. Had no idea he would become overall Summer Grand Prix champion in 2014. And also would win two World Cup competitions. Of course, who knows that if he hasn't experienced already in the age of only 21. But I don't know how it is about you, but he is easily recognizable in these images just looking at how he behaves. So part 4 of 5 is this man right here, Noriaki Kasai. Secured another entry in the record, world record book of Guinness. But only 110 meters in this attempt. But most likely will miss the second round with this result, being only 22nd at the moment. And still in the lead, our Italian friend Stefano Chiapolino. Would you believe it? Risto Jussilainen from Jyväskylä. Won two World Cup competitions in 2001. Which was also his most successful season, where he finished third in the overall World Cup. And But the Finnish athletes so far, as we are watching this competition for 41 competitors right now, struggling to get good distances. But he definitely does a good job on the telemark there, because if you follow the conditions, you also notice that you need to set a telemark right there, even though most likely it won't be enough for him for the second round. Daiki Ito, the last still active competitors, only 19 years young back then. And it took another 7 years until he claimed his first World Cup victory. And also the Japanese suffered from a few losses in the last few minutes. Only 109.5 meters, so half a meter shorter than Kasai. And so 25th place and the end of the workday for him. Wind conditions giving the jumpers a hard time as we are waiting for a German double. Georg Speth from Oberstdorf. As we also see the current standings, so Chiappolino, Stoch and Hocke still in the first three positions. And also Speth can unfortunately pack his stuff. The workday is over. When being as tall as he is, backwind is an even more extreme disadvantage. But let's see how Michael Uhrmann is going to deal with that. Currently ninth in the World Cup ranking, the man from Rastbüchel, which would have a World Cup overall winner with Severin Freund 10 years later. But this is a great jump from Michael Uhrmann, giving him the intermediate leads. Now the time for Stefano Chiappolino at the top of the ranking list is over for now. Great timing at the takeoff. And he also has the courage to attack in these circumstances. A good telemark from the 26-year-old. And that is a clear lead for Michael Uhrmann. But my feeling tells me that there is at least one man coming up to even beat that. Matti Hautamäki, up to date, didn't celebrate any victories this season. But that's a phenomenal jump from the Finn, who basically saves the reputation of his team, at least transferring it to the impression they have brought so far in this first round. But not only that, his technique is just pure pleasure to look at. He was also using the improving wind conditions a great pair. And the time as a leader for Michael Uhrmann is already over. And I don't know why, I also have the feeling that it won't come again. Andreas Witölzl for Austria. Third jump above the K-point line of 125 meters. For the Tyrolean. And that is giving him the third place, so right behind Michael Uhrmann. And there we see the youngest Austrian. Remarkable his style to prepare before the jump, climbing on the bar, then moving his goggles, hitting himself on the legs, and then throwing himself down the ski jump. Thomas Morgenstern. 125 meters also for him. Remarkably flat already his in-run position. And so he takes third intermediate place. Passt schon, so that's all right, he says. And we are about to close this first round. There is Jakub Janda, today's ski jumping director at the Czech Ski Federation. But as you probably might know, his year was yet to come. Still one of the better results for the moment, giving him sixth intermediate position, so definitely a position to attack, but he's also surrounded by Stefano Chiapolino, something he might not have believed in the first second. Adam Małysz already had three overall World Cup victories in his books already. Fourth best ski jumper in that season. And that's a solid jump for him. 124 meters. Tried to squeeze out everything you could have in this jump. Ah, distance corrected to 122 meters, so that would make ...3.6 points less. And last but not least, since we are having Rua Jökulsoy and Jana Ahonen not with us, we are going to see Martin Höllwart with bib number 50. The man from Meierhofen in Zillertal. And also a rather work shift for him. I think most of the athletes would agree if I said it's definitely a good feeling that they have managed to survive this first round, as it is over now. But there you could also see the disadvantage of not having the wind and gate calculation available, because if that would have been possible, the comp might have looked a little different and a little easier on the eyes. But at least the intermediate leader Matti Hautamäki surely satisfied, having already a clear lead ahead of Michael Uhrmann, 12.3 points. Kami Stoch on 8th place, Janne Damian 18th, Martin Höllwart, as we can see, splits the 14th place together with Maximilian Mechler, Dmitry Vasiliev on rank number 19, Denis Kornilov on amongst the top 20. And from Marco Steinauer on, unfortunately, we have to say goodbye to all the athletes following up. So, they would now have to take a look on what would come up in the second round. And at the back, we see Janne Harponen on 50th and last position. So, surprisingly, we are able to cancel the break in between the two rounds, as we are having a look on the starting order for the second round. So, Noriaki Kasai made it to the final on the very last call. At the Stadio del Trampolino, which provided nice weather conditions. 8 degrees Celsius, and the mood is good. At former former race director Walter Hofer. And the small crowd, which might be close to the inhabitant number of Pragelato itself, is looking forward to the best 30 athletes from the first round. The jury is deciding to extend the inrun length, so it won't be gate number 20 anymore. But it should be gate number 22. So, 2 gates more. Gate number 23 it is. Okay, just to slightly correct the disadvantage the athletes have from the backwind. And there we also have a brief view on the smaller hills, which are fortunately still in use, AK60, AK30 and K15 were added to the K95 and the K125, which were one of the first state-of-the-art ski jumping hills as we know them right now. The parameters haven't really changed ever since. Back in the day, it was still a new phenomenon, as we all know the K90 or K120 for normal and large hill. But with this complex, new K points and also hill sizes were established. Hill size was still a new aspect of the hill, couple of years before that, we still had the jury distance, but not on all ski jumps, which was a bit confusing, but basically wasn't too far away from what the hillsides later became. Today, the hill size is a main indicator for security and therefore also for the in-run length, obviously, which hasn't really changed ever since. But back in the day, it was an initial sign for the jury to carefully think about the in-run length if it's appropriate. But in contrast to modern ski jumping competitions, you would have to restart the whole round when changing the in-run length. So, Noriaki Kasai opening the final round here in Pragelato 2005. And immediately and easily beats the distance from his first jump. Obviously, that's expectable if you have a longer in run available. 119.5 meters, the first benchmark to beat. But behind him, the gaps between each and every jumper are very, very slim, so you could easily climb a couple of places if you beat your colleagues in the second round. So let's have a look what Risto Jussilainen can provide. And that should be enough in order to beat Kasai and remain on rank number 29 for the Finn. The only representative of his country to reach the final round. And next up is Takanobu Okabe. Also, one thing that has changed in the meantime is that today the top 30 gets prize money, 100 Swiss francs per World Cup point. Back in the day, only the top 10 received it. So you got World Cup points, yes, but you didn't win any prize money. So the 10th place certainly was more valuable because it was the magic border, as Takanobu Okabe drops on third position behind his country fella Noriaki Kasai. Andreas Goldberger from Upper Austria. Back in the day, they were thinking about establishing a ski jumping complex in the area. He was able to practice ski jumping in his hometown, but already back then the hills were a bit outdated. And so in 2010, the complex in Hinzenbach was built. But we all had no idea it would happen in 2005. Jon Oras from Norway, one of the more surprising participants in this final round. for him, it was always good to reach this success. And those were his first World Cup points throughout the 2004-2005 season. With rank number 5, which actually meant he would be on rank number 30, unfortunately. Marcin Bachleda. Hence, Oras back at least 1 point with his short jump. But also for him, the first top 30 result in the season. Only 104.5 meters. So for now, the in-run extension helped only the first few competitors. Let's see how it is about Michael Neumeier from Berchtesgaden. Only slightly better than Bachleda. Neumeier these days living in Fischen im Allgäu. A small village that is located about 5 kilometers north of Oberstdorf, who was not only World Championship host in 2005, but will become a World Championship host next season. And the preparations there, despite the current crisis that is going on, are still underway and according to plan, we can tell you. Denis Kornilov. Bronze medalist at the Universiade on the normal hill, and then took gold on the ski jump. Uy. And Wolfgang Steyert, I'm surprised he's so relaxed about that. Steps on his skis, but luckily able to save it to avoid any further rotation. Definitely a good level of body control. Maybe a bit too overambitious, the young Denis Kornilov. And fails to add more than 1 point to the 16 points he already collected in that season. Morten Solem. So Jussi Lainen and Kasai, as I've mentioned, definitely took profit of their position and climbing and climbing up the order, and we can be 100% sure, I could guarantee you, that a lot of positions were switching up between first and second round. Wolfgang Leutzel from Bad Mitterndorf. Jumps around 120 meters right there, but most likely, yeah, slightly too late there at the takeoff. And even though landing a bit bumpy, gives him the new lead ahead of Risto Jussilainen. Same distance as Noreke Kasai, but because He had quite the gap to Jussi Lainen. Almost 4 points. This jump was enough to take the lead. Robert Kranjec. I'm sure he would not have bet too much money on him reaching the final round after his first jump, but so he did. And gets quite a few points, equalizes his first distance to 114 meters. Dmitry Vasiliev, 112.5 meters in the first round. Has around 10 points to make up to reach the top 10. And definitely did a good job on maintaining his position. If Wolfgang Steinert already knew what we are knowing right now, he might have reacted a little different than just having this look. Vasiliev, thumbs up, maintains the lead and surely is able to climb another few places. Jernej Damjan. Secured his participation in the team competition the next day, which was a Saturday actually, with this result. And the Slovenian team finished actually second right there, ahead of Germany, but behind the dominating Austrians. So overall it was a good weekend for the team of Matthias Zupa. We are waiting for Michael Möllinger. Didn't expect to be on rank number 17 after the first round, after his first jump. It's always nice to see coaches being so relaxed about everything. Almost everyone having a good mood up there, no matter how the competition went, and they all already knew it was also a game of luck. Ambitious attempt from Möllinger right there. Meters. Bernie Schödler. And that gives him 6th rank. And immediately pays a visit to a journalist. Jörg Ritzerfeld. And then we almost reached a halftime of this second round already. Bit hectic there at the landing. Peter Rowein nowadays also works as a youth coach, trying to find and raise talent inside of Germany. So his coaching career definitely was not over after this not really successful intermezzo. Seventh position for Ritzafeld. Quite a few points. So that's halftime result of round two. Dmitry Vasiliev in the lead ahead of Wolfgang Leutzel and Jernej Damjan. Risto Jussilainen climbed up a lot of places. And in the back we see Denis Kornilov, who caused the only small shock moment in course of this competition so far. So we are continuing with the two 14th ranked jumpers. The first one of them is Maximilian Mechler from Isny im Allgäu. Also worked for German television as a commentator assistant after his career, which was still developing in that moment we are watching right now. Quite an okay jump. Is one of only a very few athletes that actually jumped their personal record in a cancelled competition round. Which was at the Ski Flying World Championships in Vikersund 2011. And there is Martin Höllwart coming up. Quit ski jumping in 2008 and immediately became Estonian national coach, but this relationship only lasted for 1 year. But this is a great jump he is delivering right now. One of these rare ski jumpers from the Zillertal, which is more famous for alpine skiing actually. But with Philipp Aschenwald, they now have a new star in the sphere of ski jumping. And Alexander Pointner, Austrian head coach back in the day, with a random round of applause for the new leader. So, and the second biggest surprise of the first round, Johan Eriksson from Sweden. And this hurts so bad if one of those guys from a small ski jumping nation has such a great first attempt and then massively drops in the second round. Nobody could saw that coming. Neither the first good attempt, but also those 102.5 meters in the second round. But that's how it is. Still, this was his first point result in this season. And this goes also for Jan Mazoch, who unfortunately could not set bigger footprints in ski jumping after having a horrific crash in Zakopane only 2 years after this competition here. But on this 11th of February 2015 he made a solid performance. Defending as good as he could in this second round. and being 11th at this moment, so misses a top 20 result only by a bit. Rok Benković. You could also say a mysterious or mythful career he has had, and here shows a good jump very close to the K-point line. ...124 meters. One of those phenomenal talents Slovenia has brought up from the youth categories. Yet maybe the success came a bit too quick. Like I've mentioned before in the first round, only 1 week after this one. So Helvard in the lead ahead of Benković, Vasiljev, Leutzel and Mechler, as we are coming to the top 10. Andreas Küttel from Einsiedeln. Not able to keep his spot. The man who the biggest ski jump in his home complex in Einsiedeln was named after. This was actually built, or let's say concluded in the same year. You also might know that the second biggest jump, a so-called medium hill in that complex, is named after his country fella, Simon Amann. Stefan Hocke. Second best German. Small surprise after Georg Späth could not reach the final round, also due to weak wind conditions, and he also will have a difficult time right now. And Peter Rowein, who sends him down the hill, already knows that. But this is a strong performance from the man from Oberhof. Place that also was a regular World Cup host back in the day. Also Nordic combined. Nowadays a summer Grand Prix host in that discipline. And he only misses the lead by 1.5 points behind Martin Hölvard, but it's a top 10 result for him. A great success in this very season. The second top 10 results in this season, and already the best. So let us watch what this rookie right here can do. With bib number 11, we see Kamil Stoch. Back in the day, you could hardly predict what this guy is going to achieve in his career. If you did so, then well done to you. You are a real expert, but for most of the spectators, it was a huge surprise. Three times Olympic champion. 2013, a world champion. In that very moment, in his role as a waiting person. Overall World Cup winner in 2014 and 2018. Forwards tournament winner in 2017 and 2018. And in that second victory, managing to equalize the Grand Slam, winning all four competitions at the same edition of the Forwards tournament. And back then, trained, coached by Heinz Kutin, who now became the jumping coach in the German Nordic combined team. But you could see he was already very clear in his personality, in mental strength as an athlete. Not falling apart under pressure and delivering another great jump on 121.5 meters, taking third position and scoring not only his first World Cup points but also his first top 10 result. Jakub Janda. Also good jump, but then has some issues at the outrun with the skiing there. But we also saw that some judges didn't recognize some issues the athletes had in the first round. So we will have a closer look on the style points now. Telemark is good, but then again, a lack of concentration. But like I said, judges were not too harsh with their opinions as Janda is taking third position. So, Stefano Chiapolino, he already knew it is a very special day, but what will it be good for? For some good points, we can conclude he is greeting the audience. Hannu Lepistö, coach legend. Not too happy with this attempt. I'm pretty sure also the nerves have played their role in this very moment. But huge respect overall. He drops down to 15th rank, but this was his first point result in the World Cup, but also his last one, unfortunately. Adam Mawisch. Not able to keep the pace with his colleagues before, most of the colleagues, we have to say. Even though he does a good job setting a telemark there, but that does not prevent him from losing a bit. Sixth rank. But still having a chance to come inside the top 10 and also the prize money ranks, as I've mentioned. Andreas Wiethölzl. So now the fight for the podium is on. Wiethölzl only 0.5 points behind his teammate Thomas Morgenstern, who will come right after him. But this Morgenstern already showed he also can handle the pressure, which Wiethölzl now even has to create, and he fails to do so. also lacking of proper wind conditions. Unlucky, nothing you can do about it, even if you perform on your very best level. Mother Nature always plays her role, and Vitorsil no chance on the podium. But what can Thomas Morgenstern do? The last hope for Austria, but it wasn't too much pressure for the only 18-year-old, the youngest team member back then. Already had a comeback behind him after his first terrific crash in Ruka, and there is showing a nice jump and knows what it's good for. And he takes the lead with his jump. Obviously, the gap to the guys that were leading was too big. And so he maintains his position and secures another podium in his career. Morgenstern ahead of Hilvard. And now Michael Uhrmann, the only hope for Germany. Is he able to defend A, the wind conditions, and B, the attack of Morgenstern, who was just 1.7 points behind him? Yes, he is! That's a podium for Michael Uhrmann. And he immediately knows it and also celebrates it. Totally reasonable. Made two clear jumps, two solid jumps. Fought it against all resistances. And there were not too many reasons to smile for Peter Rowein at that time. But that was definitely a good occasion. After he won with the team in Villingen, it's the second podium for Uhrmann in this season. And now we will witness the second jump of today's winner. Matti Hautamäki saves it. What a dominant performance from the man from Kuopio. His first World Cup victory in the season, and there was literally no doubt about that. Even though the Finnish excitement is in a low level, but deep inside, believe it or not, deep inside, he was the happiest man in the ski jumping world. A fantastic competition of Hautamäki. He was just jumping in another lead. And so he celebrated the first of six World Cup victories. And all of them actually were coming in a row. The train driver took the fast lane today, and he was the only second ski jumper ever to win six competitions in a row. Only Janne Ahonen did that before he did, and that was actually in the same season. So a great year for ski jumping in Finland. Ahonen won the overall World Cup, and Hautamäki the Nordic tournament. So we are scrolling through the final results. Stefano Chiappolino finishing 20th. that's actually a remarkable position to stay in, especially if you collect only once World Cup points. And Johan Eriksson, our friend from Sweden, dropped to 27th position. But unfortunately, Hautamäki was lacking of performance by his other colleagues, so Finland was not able to claim a podium the next day. But the year after, it was a great time for them. They secured the silver medal in the team competition, which was won by, of course, Austria. So the overall World Cup standings, not too much has changed there up front, because the gaps between the jumpers were already a bit too big. We also see here Alexander Herr, who was not part of this competition. The man from Black Forest, who was fighting for a spot on the team competition at the Olympics next year. He didn't make the cut and then split up with the German Ski Federation. Tried to find another one, but then eventually finished his ski jumping career. So, Thomas Morgenstern on third place. Seventh podium in this season for the Austrian. And it would not take too much time until another Austrian talent would come up and show some performances and things the world hasn't seen before. Of course, we are talking about Gregor Schlierenzauer. But also those veterans such as Michael Uhrmann always played their role in ski jumping, as well as very unique guys such as Matti Hautamäki. This performance was just pure dominance. 23.7 points ahead of Uhrmann. He has won it. Couldn't be much clearer, especially on such a ski jump. So it was a great premiere for Pragelato as a World Cup host, and also the team competition the next day proved to be a good one, even though the amount of spectators was not the highest. I mean, the Piemonte region doesn't have the biggest tradition in ski jumping, so it is definitely explainable. Also, yeah, with the lack of population this village has, and so the capacity for this stadium was only by 9,000 spectators. And of course, we are also gonna take you to the victories ceremony for the best three athletes, which took place shortly after the competition, just as it is a common picture in these times.
The flowers will be handed over by Mr. Walter Marin, Mayor of Pragelato.
Sesto classificato, in rappresentanza della Repubblica Ceca.
Sixth place, representing the Czech Republic. Big round of applause for Jakub Janda.
But as we see, not only the top three get their reward. Back in the day, it was the top six that were allowed to step closer to the podium. So we see Jakub Janda and now also Stefan Hocke up next. Is Martin Höllwart.
Matti Hautamäki, Michael Urban, Thomas Morgenstern, Martin Höllwart, Stefan Hocke, Jakub Janda.
Con un bel applauso ai primi sei atleti classificati, vincitore Matti Hautamäki, Finlandia, secondo classificato Michael Urman, Germania, terzo classificato Thomas Morgenstern, Austria.
On the other hand, if you have been present at that day, you can tell, well, I was part of the first ever World Cup competition in Pragelato, and maybe if everyone knew, there wouldn't be so many more to follow, probably a few more spectators would have made their way up the Sestriere Valley to this place. So, as we once more enjoy the winner's jump, I can already tell you that the next poll is coming up next week, actually, and will last until Tuesday, the 26th of May. And we can already promise you we have found something special in our archives we can show you, but then you guys out there, the ski jumping family, has to make the decision which of the two events it's gonna be. I can't and I also won't tell you which ones we have selected for this poll, but If you enjoyed this one as much as we did, make sure to have our social media activities on your radar and check for the next poll. We hope you liked this one and you will also like the next one. We also have this series in our other disciplines, such as alpine skiing, cross-country skiing, but also in Nordic Combined, where we will also have the poll next week, finishing on Friday the 22nd of March at 12 a.m. So if you also liked these sports, also head over to their respective pages and make your vote. We're coming to the end of this broadcasting. I hope you enjoyed our trip back to the past and are ready for the next one. I can tell from my side it's a huge pleasure to commentate these for you. So, one last time, my name is Luis Holoch. Thank you very much for tuning in. Stay healthy, stay safe in these difficult times. And until next time, bye bye.